Give you a big welcome, and also just to give you a brief overview of Audience Revolution, which is one of the three key points in TCG's strategic plan, along with our equity, diversity, and inclusion in our Theater Nation programs. We've been doing Audience Revolution for a number of years now. We're in our second round, specifically of grant programs and conferencing. There are four main components to it. The first is a research piece, and Kevin, when he comes up, will be referring to some of the work that we've been doing with AMS Consulting. We had the second of our Audience Revolution convenings in Kansas City recently. I know a lot of you are nodding your heads because you were there, and the one before was in Philly. We've got a grant program, and spread among you are 10 of the grant recipients from the first round, and later on, Kevin Bitterman will be talking about how we envision the second round of the program. And then dissemination is a big piece, which is what we're doing exactly right now. Some of the handouts up here are case studies. They're drafts of case studies. AMS, our consulting firm, did a lot of research both with individuals, audiences, and theaters, and then dove deeper into phone interviews and then also actually 8 case studies. So these are 4 that are the preview version, and we're going to have the other 4 available within the next couple of weeks and then also on the website, but that should just whet your appetite a little bit. And we're partnering with the Wallace Foundation and their book here, The Road to Results. If you haven't already seen it, it's a really informative little booklet here. So with that, I'm going to call up Kevin Eatmore to take us through the morning.
Thanks. like Amelia said, we've really been working on this research, and we've worked with AMS Planning and Research. Lynette, I just want to give a shout out to, because she was so helpful with this. No kidding. But what we wanted to do was find ways to quantify and define the different audience engagement and community development strategies that are being used by theaters around the country. In this research, we identified sort of 5 audience engagement strategy clusters. And if you'll turn your attention to the screen in front of you, these are generally the 5 strategy clusters we found to be most prevalent in the field. And what we're going to do is I'm going to go through these really quick, and then we're going to hear examples from all of these, from some of our grantees that are actually using some of these. I think it's really important to note these clusters are rarely used solely, you know what I'm saying, by themselves. I mean, usually people are using a combination of these different strategy clusters. But of these strategy clusters, the highest percentage of theaters are using relationships. So that means really building or enhancing the personal relationships that you have with your community, with other groups, you know, in your community, social services, audiences, you name it. I mean, anybody that sort of makes up your community. The second highest identified cluster is segmentation. So that's defining and expanding and refining the intended people to be served by your work. So you're actually segmenting, you know, trying to reach young people, trying to reach the LGBT community, trying to reach seniors, trying to reach Latinos, whoever you've decided that you would like to actually see in your theater. The next highest group is content. So that means actually doing different work, putting different work on stage, in order to try and draw audiences that you would like to see in your theater. 19% of theaters said that they worked on the venue. So that's really rethinking the place where you engage your work. How people get to your theater, or taking the theater outside of the theater to the people. I mean, that's a very popular sort of strategy right now. And last but not least, and it's really interesting because I think a lot of people think that income, redesigning the financial exchange, who pays how much for what and for whom. You know, we always think A lot of theaters are using discounts or, dynamic pricing. But really, in the strategy clusters, it was identified as like the least used. Now, that's not to say it's not being used, but and like I said, I think that most of the theaters are using a combination of all of these different strategy clusters. It's really important to note that in addition to these strategies and approaches, the biggest factor that really continues to come up in regards to the success of any audience engagement project, regardless of any of these approaches, is the work. Audiences really, the data tells us that both anecdotal and statistical that regardless of what strategy you're working on, having a positive response to the art experience on stage is still like the most vital component to audience retention and increased engagement. So keep that in mind while we go through these examples of each kind of strategy cluster. The work really is a very important part of this. And again, a lot of what you're gonna hear today really is probably a combination of some of these clusters together, put together. So actually what we're gonna do first is talk about relationship strategies. And this is really building the personal relationships, like I said before, that the organization has with the community. And in order to do that, I'm going to invite our friends from the Oregon Shakespeare Festival. Where, who is?
There you go. First. To talk about, yeah.
So, hello, my name is Freda Casillas, and I'm the Audience Development Manager at the Oregon Shakespeare Festival. And the photo there you see is Portland Ambassadors, and that is part of our TCG grant. At OSF, we sell close to 400,000 tickets every year. Oregon Shakespeare Festival, we have 3 to 5 Shakespeare shows of the 11 that we present every year. We have a fantastic audience. Our leadership with Bill Rausch and Cynthia Ryder really wants us to focus on action steps so that we make our audience inclusive. And you might have heard of the Audience Development Manifesto that came as a result of my program. We focus on inviting ethnic communities to OSF. We do that by cultivating relationships, inviting new groups, and we do that with introductory prices. We actually negotiate with a new group what they can actually afford, and we comp also education programming for those groups also. We invite these groups to experience what our new audiences, what our current audiences have as a relationship with OSF, and we're a destination theater. So when folks come to see us, they come to vacation, they come to celebrate, they come to be stimulated with new ideas, they come to nurture their heart, and they come to fall in love again. Because with Romeo and Juliet recently, I had different couples tell me, individually, the wife would say to me, I am coming here to fall in love again with my husband, and that has happened. And husbands also told me that also. So as we cultivate relationships that are sustainable, we do that with customized experiences and customized programming. And the 5 programs that are funded by our TCG grant are, number one, an education program that we collaborated with Impact Theater in Chicago. A couple of us went to Impact and saw what they were doing as far as teaching what storytelling means and also how storytelling is constructed. We had a wonderful partner that we cultivated in Portland named Connie Hines, who is one of the best connectors in the world. And she sent us to a high school that didn't have this kind of art engagement. What we have discovered from that model is that it's a wonderful way to cultivate new schools by actually giving them the educational experience that we have amalgamated with Impact. And that's gonna keep going. We're gonna keep giving these free educational sessions so that these schools will sign up for our other programs. Number two, I'm gonna save that for last, Luis Alfaro is another point in this program, and he is our first resident playwright. We're close to 80 years old at OSF, and we have just had our first resident playwright. He is Latino. He is a storyteller, And he is a person who cultivates relationship from one conversation with a group. And we had him cultivate those with Portland State University, Partners in Diversity, and many other social justice organizations. Another part of our program is a program evaluation that we're currently doing right now with the Nonprofit Association of Portland. And really, the program evaluation was supposed to be really showing us what successes we've had, where we need to grow. And interestingly enough, it wasn't just about my program. It wasn't just about cultural connections. They suggested that we do this for all of OSF. So it's really just phase one of what we're doing with them. The other part is Spanish open captioning, and we're upgrading that. And we are upgrading that because Latino families told us, we want to come with our grandparents, we want to come with our mothers. You need to do Spanish open captioning for us. And it's had a lot of success, and now we're looking at a different language also. And this picture right here is the ambassador program. We have local ambassadors in the Rogue Valley in Oregon. We're 5 hours away from Portland. These folks have all volunteered to be ambassadors for OSF. And they went through a program that included dinners with actors, learning about diversity in the theater, learning about marketing programs. They came to us from recommendations from organizations from the Latino Network, the Hispanic Metropolitan Chamber, Partners in Diversity, many other social justice organizations. The reason we do this is because word of mouth is pivotal in what we do in Oregon. We have so many referrals already from these folks on the photo, and I will give you two quotes that they gave us. Number one, seeing an African-American woman performing on the main stage, a main character in the Shakespeare play, was emotionally uplifting. The casting in all plays was wonderful. And number two, I was floored by the commitment by OSF to engage individuals of color in such a direct way and for specifically allocating resources to its mission. It is rare. And then they all stood up and cheered and then shouted out ideas that they had. So we're on our way. Thank you.
Thank you.
So I think you can hear, like I was saying, that this is, I mean, it's sort of a combination of all of the different strategy clusters. But what we want you to do right now, am I right about this, JP?
Yes.
Everybody to talk in their own group about, can you explain that a little bit?
Yeah. So for just real quick, we're going to just do, just kind of in your circles, when you're thinking about this strategy cluster of relationship, like what's like one like question you have about it? Or what's one like way that you think this would be highly beneficial as kind of a dominant strategy for, or for dominant cluster for like your particular strategy that you're thinking about?
Good. And we're going to do that for each one as
yeah.
we go through.
Yeah.
So take 5 minutes, talk amongst yourselves.
Hi.
We just have a discussion. I'm Hallie. I step into your company.
All of our relationships, it's all about the relationships, right? That's who comes as a partner to the partners. It's always about how to try to expand the relationship building takes a lot of time.
And to try to and find those connections so that it's not just looked at as the other, as the question.
And so I just throw that out. Yeah, and they have to be, genuine relationships. Because if this, I'm sure they will continue this work. I learned more about this project yesterday, and they will continue this work. But if it was a one-year project, which is ambassadors, or if it was about enlightening more people about the great work that my organization does, so that they all show up at my door, that can't be necessarily a project. A relationship. It's work, and it's a two-way street. It's a fantastic. Right.
For me, I think that one of the things that we have found is the most important element in dealing with building relationships is treatment. And so acknowledging the financial side of it, I think, is not something to avoid when it is
we're with that actually. Okay, great.
I just filled it out. Our tradition comes from, we came out of the looking at parks and recreation centers. Wherever people were, that's what we were. Our space, in a lot of ways, is a community culture. So there's a lot of, so if you have a hot button issue in the community, there's a space for those kind of conversations. Nonprofit groups are trying to do that, and also provide those who are keys to those relationships.
I think that's kind of what we all want, right? To have this point where people engage with the art, they engage with the issues.
Hey guys, I hate to do this. I feel like I'm interrupting, but we're going to move on and talk about another cluster. Okay. And you know what? I just want to say, you're going to get to do more of this type of work this afternoon, okay? So, like, don't stop thinking and don't stop talking. I mean, stop talking right now, but... but you're going to be able to talk a lot more to each other. We're going to explore right now the segment strategy, and this is really defining and refining the intended people that you want to be served by the institution. Examples are focusing by age, ethnicity, geography, participation, preference, etc., etc. And I think who we're going to hear from first is Hallie from Steppenwolf.
Hey.
Where?
Hi, I'm right here. You have two mics.
Oh, you
do. Hi, everybody. I'm going to read from this just because, like it was said before, we're combining so many efforts into this one, so I just want to make sure I touch specifically on the segmentation. Currently, Steppenwolf, we're really good at programming for adults with our subscription shows, and we're really good at programming for youth. And when I say youth, I say ages. We program specifically for ages 14 through 19. And we do two shows a year that are very specific to that target audience. What we found is really challenging is that seldom these two groups, meaning our subscriber house audience and the audience for our youth program productions, do they come together in one place, in one viewing. And so we thought it would be really exciting to figure out a way to combine these groups with a focused intention on creating experiences in which youth and adults learn and benefit from one another. And this is not, and when I talk about this, I'm not talking about a family audience, but I'm talking about teens who are sitting next to an adult who they have no idea who they are, and vice versa. And how do we get those two audiences together around the same production? So our target segment is a multi-generational audience comprised of members of different generations, including teens, which are associated with our Steppenwolf for Young Adults programming, adult subscribers to Steppenwolf's main stage show. And some of these subscribers do come over to see our Steppenwolf for Young Adult productions, but only if they're title recognition, like To Kill a Mockingbird, Book Thief, and Animal Farm. But when we commission new work, we see a significant drop-off of adult participation. So we decided to create a piece of work for the stage called The Compass, which is devised and directed by Michael Rode, which will be on our main stage in the winter. This will be something very new in terms of it has audience participation, which we suspect that our adult subscriber audiences will probably not be used to, I'll say. So what we're doing is we're creating a series of these audience engagement events with youth beforehand that are all about decision making, because that's what the Compass play is going to be about. It's going to be about decision making and how we make decisions. Now, when we have these events, and this is a picture of one of them, we had, and this was around, all the events relate back to the work on our stages. So this was an event that was about decision making around the play on our subscription show called The Herd. And it was, the theme of it was, if you had one do-over, what would you do? So we had an 11-year-old girl tell her story. We had a teenager tell their story, what would they do over, and then we had someone in their early 30s, someone in their 50s, and then someone in their 70s. And so by that, and then we broke them off into groups and had them talk to each other. We purposely put together young people with adults who did not know each other. Again, what happened there is that both the youth and the adult are on equal footing. So they're no longer parent, teacher, authority figure, but they're a learner, and so is the youth. And so that, and then they all go to see the play after that. And so these events, we've had six of these events so far, and we are bringing all of these events and all of these audience participation to the Compass play that will happen, in which we have hopefully massaged well enough this audience so that they're able to engage and interact with that play as well.
Thanks, awesome. So next we're gonna hear from Seema Swicko at Pasadena Playhouse.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Seema Sueko. I work as the Associate Artistic Director at Pasadena Playhouse. So for our Audience Revolution grant, our strategy was segment, and specifically we wanted to increase arts participation among Latino communities in the San Gabriel Valley, which is the region where we're located. We were specifically focusing on adult populations, so ages 18 and up, and specifically focusing our work off our campus, so it also intersected with the venue strategy. We engage in a methodology called consensus organizing for theater. It's an artistic methodology that has roots in community organizing, and it's a type of organizing through which a theater deliberately and intentionally builds stake in multiple pockets of communities, and those communities deliberately and intentionally build stake back in the theater by surfacing and organizing around mutual self-interest. And by using that strategy, we went out into a variety of communities in the San Gabriel Valley and surfaced four major partnerships. And by asking them, what do you really want? And engaging in intentional conversations, some of the programming of our Audience Revolution grant included things like working with an organization called Imagine Action, doing Theater of the Oppressed workshops throughout Northwest Pasadena that resulted in a community-devised forum play. We worked with the City of La Puente, Art Walk, and Pasadena City College. Both of those organizations were really interested in art installations along with staged readings of existing plays. And then we also commissioned a new musical by Ozo Motley, the Grammy Award-winning band. All in all, our program directly engaged 1,000 individuals, 78% self-identifying as Latino, and all off our campus. But I'd like to identify or discuss some of the long-lasting results of this work. With the Imagine Action Partnership, as soon as we got off our campus and started asking folks, what do you really want? They said, well, you know, we think it's really great that you're out here, but when are you going to put Latinos on your main stage? And so we heard that, and I'm so pleased to say that I'll be directing Real Women Have Curves by Josefina Lopez to kick off our next season as a direct result of what we heard out in the community. Also, when we started doing the Theater of the Oppressed and Forum Play work out in the community, several other organizations heard about it and saw it and are now requesting it. So we now have a James Irvine grant to allow us to continue this work out in the community. And also, one of the organizations we met being out in the community is a group called Adelante Youth Alliance, and they've already contacted us and said we want to buy out the house when you do Real Women Have Curves. So it's, you know, it's having a direct impact on our ticket sales. With the city of La Puente, as a long-term impact of this grant, the city itself is now looking at creating, for the first time in their history, a public art program. And if that's a result of this Audience Revolution grant, that's, I think, a triumph. With the Pasadena City College, their involvement with us in this program, and this is actually a photo from the reading of Stand and Deliver, which is about Jaime Escalante, who was an alum of Pasadena City College. And this is just one of many partnerships we have with PCC. Last year, they bought 200 tickets to our production of Kiss Me Kate, which was told through an African-American lens, and then 200 tickets through for our production of Stop Kiss. Next season, they're already buying 400 tickets to Real Women Have Curves and 400 tickets to Fly. And with each of those partnerships, they embed the show in their curriculum. We use their professors as experts in our talkbacks, and it's a mutually beneficial partnership where we're each serving our self-interests. And then, of course, the long-term impact with the commissioning of the musical is that we continue to work on that musical by Ozo Motley, so we'll be doing more workshops of that next season. Internally for us, a long-term impact was that it helped us discover that this process of consensus organizing for theater works, and so we've codified it further. We last week held an internal workshop so that to get everybody on board with this process. We've now have like a working document of the philosophy of CO, consensus organizing, the six-step process, et cetera. And then we've also gone out and taught this process to others. So Trinity Rep is now incorporating consensus organizing. I went out and taught it there. People's Light, Mixed Blood. And so we're finding sort of a cohort of organizations using this methodology in a variety of different settings, and that's a long-term impact. I think just to summarize, what I'll say is this: what I love about this grant program is it's called Audience Revolution, as if to imply that, you know, your audience will be revolutionized, and certainly that did happen. But I think the what I think is intentional on TCG's part in designing this is it's really also about organizational transformation. So by going out with this process, it forced us as an organization to really transform how we work, how we make decisions, and restructure some things and use new methodology. Thanks.
Love it. That's great. And next we're going to hear from Mika at Su Teatro in Denver.
Hi. For our project, we opted to work with a specific population within our audience base. So we are a Chicano Latino theater company that is 42 years old, and many of our audience members have grown up with our organization. And so looking at the Latino population in the country, and in Denver specifically, the largest growing part of that are the youth. So we worked and specified people that were 14 to 25, that were either first generation or immigrants themselves coming into the city. And we were working with this population in our, as part of our staff, as part of our company, and as part of our students that we serve in our education programs. So the idea was to take those people that are already engaged in our organization, that are already members of our life, and create a cohort of them to specifically outreach to other people in that population. So the first thing we did was bring them together and start some focus groups and start talking about it. And they said, okay, we're in, we want to go out, we want to do whatever, but what's marketing? How do we do this? And what do we do? So one of the things we did is we took time weekly to use some of the staff members and work studies and artists that were engaged in that way and created kind of mini workshops within our own organization on what is marketing, how to do that. We incorporated it into all of our education programs. Every production in the classes that we were already teaching had a direct connect. So we did a show called Enrique's Journey in the fall, which is about an immigrant traveling to reunite with his mother in North Carolina from Honduras. And all of our students then went and said, what is your journey story? What is your journey and how do we tell it? And they reacted in different ways from creating their story, creating a play of their skits of their story that other kids helped them perform or however. And those became part of the engagement strategies and having them be at the theater to perform this. This particular piece, we did a show called 48, which is about two bombings in Boulder that happened in 1972. The whole cast was under 30 years old. So they engaged with the whole process of creating the play, but then you also have people that lived the experience and they had the intermixing between those. This was from an art exhibit that the students also created that was in the entryway coming into the performance. So other things that they did throughout the year included creating videos, creating Facebook hashtags. Some members of the cohort were able to go with us to the Latino Theater Encuentro, and so they had national exposure. I'm gonna fast forward, sorry. Okay, so long-term results that are impacting the organization is that having a greater voice and expectation in the marketing and the programming that we do overall, deeper commitment and engagement with the organization and consideration. The integration with education, the youth company itself has created a Snapchat and Instagram in that piece, and also having access to space for their voice to be heard. So one of the big projects that we're working on is activating our parking lot and behind our parking lot in a San Arta project, where we give other organizations and other and our youth company access to performance space throughout the year.
I think one of the things that I'm noticing as we listen to all of these stories is this work is labor intensive. I mean, it's really labor intensive, but it pays off. You know, gone are the days when you just put an ad out. I mean, you've really got to engage your audience. So anyway, talk amongst yourselves for about 5 minutes about segmentation, and then we're going to come back. Go.
One thing, coming back to what you said at the very, very end, one of the things we say, if you got areas kind of ticket, that means somebody else diverse above that in the
population.
So I would rather have 300 people paying $10 a piece and two people paying $150. So it's a choice that you could.
We went from about 5 years ago, we went from a model where we gave away 9 comps as needed. Or as there was need for, to a model where now we select every show, every ticket, you pick your price, zero to whatever, and our average ticket price went up. It's been very successful for us.
We do have a hard
subscription model that I don't think we ever had a subscription model. We have people who, we have patrons who are really used to subscribing to theaters who ask us for a subscription. We'll cover something. We will call it their season tickets, but literally anybody can, if you want to reserve a ticket online. That's $5, but even if you just
just call and reserve a ticket, you can reserve a ticket for $0 or whatever you think. And so we have, and really the only people who pay nothing are artists or other people who would have expected to get comps anyway. And then we have the, anything from that all the way to the people who really like to make use that as a make their annual gift through buying a couple of tickets at $100 or something like that. So, and, but mostly, like I said, it's a big and it brought up our average ticket price.
Trying to get those communities to come out to see the show. Our normal audiences, which are
They choose. We let them know that the face value of the ticket is usually $25. We don't tell them this in advance, but I'm the developer person, so if they pay more than $25 for their ticket, I count above $25 as a deductible donation.
That was a challenge for us. That's
signal ticket.
We found a solution. We definitely chose programming around the second edition.
And it also seems to me that every time we get a
Rika's journey, although it's a big story about immigration, is really a story of a young man coming of age. It's a journey, it's not necessarily just a physical journey. It's taking responsibility. And there's another element. It's really popular in the high schools and the colleges that teach the book, because the book is a military type of book. So there was a built-in audience.
But that essentially encouraged me more, and it's actually forced us to rethink our reservation policy.
It's a story about a Central American kid from Central America. We don't have a Central American. Adults can relate to it because it has a lot of
demand. You can take the bus to see us within 5 minutes.
But for the kids, they get the whole conversation. His search is not only for a physical space. It's a boy looking for his mom. How universal is that story?
So there was
a reason for us to look for kids. I was going to say that unfortunately, real women have curves. We did the same show too. We ran the 90% of the house, and we did not. We had other things scheduled. We did segments of women.
I've got to interrupt again. Sorry.
I'm sorry. Come back.
Stop talking.
Yeah.
No. I know, right? All right. So next we're going to talk about content. And what we mean by content, I mean it's doing different work rather than doing like the work that you're doing differently. Does that make sense? It's like putting different work on stage. Some examples are like audience participation in the artistic process of developing new work, performances that solicit or encourage audience participation, or substantial educational offerings. And the first group we're going to hear from is Tom Quaintance from Cape Fear Regional Theater.
Hey, I wasn't told that this was not going to be a traditional theater space, so I designed this for proscenium, sorry. Fast forward ahead. There we are. So I got it. So Cape Fear Regional Theater is located in Fayetteville, North Carolina, which is home of Fort Bragg and the 82nd Airborne, the largest military base in the world. So our project was intended to change the way we do audience engagement by putting that audience at the center of the art-making experience. We partnered with Hidden Voices, which is a Chapel Hill-based nonprofit specializing in going into underserved communities and finding their story and giving it a voice. We also partnered with Mike Wiley, who wrote The Parchment Hour, which we had an incredibly successful run of a couple of years before, and he already had some pull in our community. So, and the intention of the project was not just to give this we were taking military spouses' experience of deployment, the impact of deployment on families from the spouse point of view, from the family point of view. And we wanted to create a play that would be able to stand up to a three-week run in a regional theater. So we were looking to create a piece of art. And we started with these community workshops where we asked questions about, you know, what are the questions we should be asking, and then encouraged conversation around those questions. Mike was in those workshops. We had recorded them, we transcribed them. And we also, part of the workshop that was very interesting was there was a visual artist that was engaged, and everybody created these kind of diorama boxes, sort of care packages that they would then send to either their younger self or a new spouse. And not only was the art cool, but some of the most important stories and material was developed around the creating of this artwork. Something about taking it away from the formality of sitting down and talking opened up the conversation. So we had a workshop where probably the most important thing that was said before that was, look, Mike, we don't know that this is going to work. So, you know, don't feel like you need to come into this with a finished product or having all the answers. We had a really good group of artists. We had a music director and a choreographer, and played around for a week with the text. And what we came out with was something that had promise, but was kind of a mess, and it wasn't really a play. But we had a private stage reading for some of the people that we felt like, okay, are we getting this right? And then sent Mike off on his way to continue working. Keju Sanchez sent me an email in October saying, hey, we're at TCG, we're looking at putting this thing together with Paul Vogel. That was a theater, veterans and theater initiative, and we had a half day conversation around the issues of, it was a wide ranging conversation, but the thing that I took away from it was talking about some of the difficulties of documentary theater in general and documentary theater with veterans in particular. And the result of that was this is where we decided we were much more of a content cluster than a segment cluster. We were kind of trying to do both in the beginning, and we decided, okay, we need to refocus this really specifically on the content and put more resources toward supporting Mike in writing this play. So new play reading, my first and second, we targeted very specifically the military families and community leadership to be our audience for this reading. And also between those two times, we committed to doing the plays before we had a script that we thought would work next year. So we're gonna do the world premiere next year. And but in this reading, we targeted the military community and the leadership, community leadership to be our audience. 87% military audience in this reading. And it was extraordinary. I've never been in an audience that was that engaged, and the talkbacks we had afterwards were as long as the play. And it was passionate, smart, and thrilling. And the artwork ended up being a sort of another intersection of another opportunity to engage the audience in the process as a whole. So, next year we're doing it as part of our season. It's our first world premiere. I guess there was one 30 years ago at the theater, but it's the first one in 30 years. So we're very excited to be presenting Downrange next year.
Cool. All right, and actually I think that's a really good example of use of a combination of the three strategy clusters we just have been talking about. I mean, it's really content and relationship and segmentation. So, like I mentioned before, you rarely use just one, it's usually a combination. Standing and stretching, or are they talking? I'm gonna hand it over to Amelia.
Just a couple things. We are gonna be standing and stretching and giving you a moment to just take a bio break. There are some bathrooms across the lobby, should you need to. And when you come back, it would be great if you're actually sitting in a different circle. That way you could engage with a different group of people. The other thing to keep in mind that the afternoon session is going to be about prototyping. So hopefully you've come in with ideas, strategies, models that you just want some group think around. And we'll be having you fill out some intake forms at the end of this morning session. So then during the break, staff can scramble and try to organize you into the different clusters. That'll all make sense. Suffice to say that as you're listening and thinking, you might want to think about which cluster your project that you want to work on falls into, because that will be very helpful. So let's take five, stand, stretch. The long hall for the bathrooms is across the lobby. See you back in another circle.
There's some interesting new transferable projects and ideas, but the way the afternoon is going to go away, it's going to be about everyone in this room droning. Challenges, questions. So it's going to.
But that really.
Right now, we're.
I have a challenge with that.
Well, and that's in that sense, that's how I have a challenge with that. So right now, that's kind of what's happening. The people who are speaking are they're active talking to the students, and they're talking about what they've been doing as it fits into these strategies.
An hour and a half, or 2 and a half.
So. And they're really sessions are really
So have you read the
I'm
going to grab my phone with them and say, but I'm not going far though. I just want to see the message that came in. So.
I'm going to go to the next one.
All right. Find new seats. Did you change places? Some people did. Some people don't like to change seats, you know. But if you can find a new seat, new people, new ideas. You know what we did inadvertently was we skipped the turn and talk portion of the content, and I'm gonna like ask this group, would you like to talk about content for 5 minutes, or do you want to move on? If you want to talk about content for 5 minutes, raise your hand. Just you, okay, we can just talk. So I think we're gonna move on to venue and path. And venue and path strategy is really rethinking the place that people engage with the organization's work and the road that they follow to find it. Some examples are performing in non-traditional venues, actually working with your venue, with the venue that you're in to sort of transform that space, or have people find it in a different way, or delivering new content via the web or media channels. And we are going to, is this correct? Yes. We're gonna hear from Corey from Pillsbury House and Theater in Minneapolis. Or is it St. Paul? It's Minneapolis. Twin Cities, let's just say.
Okay, come on.
There you go.
Again, I'm Corey. I'm from Pillsbury House in Minneapolis. I'm flipping to the beginning of my presentation. I'm sure some of you at least know Ralph Remington. Ralph Remington started Pillsbury House Theater in 92 as a professional theater, working in the context of an inner city community center with programs like a child care center, after school summer programs, a free integrated healthcare clinic. We have a bike shop that provides job skills to homeless youth and many other human service programs. Ralph started some great programs like the Chicago Avenue Project, which uses the model from the 52nd Street Project for kids to write and perform in new plays alongside adult performers. Let's see what else. So the thing that makes us very unique is that in 2008, when the Great Recession was starting, one of the things that happened to keep the whole center viable was that the management of all of those human service programs was merged under the direction of the theater's two artistic directors. So let that sink in for a minute. There were bumps along the way, but it was part of a bigger plan to use art as a foundation for all of those programs, not as an added arts activity for the kids to do, to take up some more time, but really as a foundational part of the curriculum to improve the outcomes of those programs. That's mostly done through three resident teaching artists who each work in multiple programs, developing and implementing curricula along with the program staff for those programs. And so they're doing, you know, storytelling, playwriting, acting, poetry, spoken word with some of the older teens, movement and dance, lots of other things. So there's art coming out of every corner of the building. It's been really wildly successful. Based on our successes integrating art inside the building, we've started using art as a community organizing tool out in these neighborhoods that we serve. So, for example, we got an art place grant to work with artists living in these four neighborhoods we serve, there are many artists living in these four neighborhoods, commissioned artists to develop 20 placemaking projects along the commercial corridor that goes through all four of those neighborhoods. Another project is called Art Blocks, and here we commission, again, artists living in those neighborhoods to meet everyone who lives on their block and create art in whatever their own discipline is to respond specifically to that audience. So, 2 years ago, the TCG Audience Revolution convening and then this grant program really provided a great catalyst for us to take these things we've been doing inside the building and then things that we were starting to take outside the building and really, for the first time, point them back at our main stage productions, because we weren't just doing neighborhoods theater. I mean, this is our Arts Weekly named us the best theater in the Twin Cities a couple of years ago. Last year, our state's biggest daily named us the best small theater venue in the state. We commission plays like Tracy Scott's Wilson's Buzzer, which the public theater is doing this season. So we're doing very high level work. And our goal is to keep the statistics as few as possible, but if 90% of the people in the human service programs come from these four neighborhoods that we serve, only about 25% of our main stage audience comes from these four neighborhoods. So, and it's a small 96-seat theater, so I don't need to double my audience size, but I want to increase the percentage of the audience that is coming from these neighborhoods that we're trying to serve. So, what we did with our TCG project, using some of the lessons learned and those other things, was we commissioned artists to create artwork based on the themes of the main stage productions. I've got 1 minute left. And then the art was installed inside the building, outside the building, to create new paths to bring people along. So this is an installation that went along with John Adams, Gideon's Knot. These classroom installations were set up with workbook books. You can see an illustration of one of the assignments. People are invited to sit down. Another project, we had an artist work with patients in the free clinic in the building and created these beautiful WPA style posters exploring issues of healthcare in our country to go along with Michael Milligan's Mercy Killers. So now what we found is, I will skip to the good stuff that has happened because of this. We're now suddenly deeply rooted with many more artists in our community. And so, for example, in the current production that we have happening right now, the set designer was inspired to want, he wanted to include some silkscreen printing in the set design, and it was getting a little late in the process, and he wasn't sure how to incorporate that, but he said, oh wait, you had somebody here doing silkscreen printing. And so the person who made those posters to go with Mercy Killers, we were able to then bring her in, and it was somebody who we had a relationship with, understands our work, and we're able to use these other things that we're doing to strengthen other art that's happening in our community.
Cool. All right. So, next, JP.
Wooly.
We're going to hear from Kelsey at Portland Center Stage.
So this is a picture of me. I was so scared they would use this one, but oh well, they did. So, there it is. Our Audience Revolution Project at Portland Center Stage had two main components. Number one, develop a gaming app with a loyalty component that rewards engagement. Number two, create a touring performance that goes out into the community to raise awareness of who we are, but also use that as a tool to sign people up for this digital loyalty gaming app. So you can see how this relates to the venue pass strategy, how and where people engage with our work, a new digital property, and also an outreach tour. Now we have this very iconic building, the Girding Theater in the Portland Armory, and it's been the center of our engagement programming. It's very robust, animating the space 24/7. So after about 7 years in this building, I thought, okay, we need to go out. We need to send something out. So we built the tour, and then having all this engagement programming that we've really seen some positive changes in who our audience is, who's coming to the theater, who knows about us, kind of beefing that up and rewarding people for engaging in engagement activities. So what we ended up was Playmaker is what we call this. And Aphelous is my abbreviation for the tour, which is called All's Fair in Love and Shakespeare. Simple 50-minute, six scenes of Shakespeare's lovers going out to galleries, parks, farmers markets, libraries, cultural centers around the Portland metro region. And Playmaker actually changed from a gaming app to become more of a digital loyalty portal, is what we're calling it. So really, it ended up being a points rewards
system with a gaming component, and down kind of in the shaded area where my title is, you can kind of see our proscenium and some set pieces. If we scrolled down, you would see the gaming portion, which is the more points you earn, you can populate our proscenium with set pieces, costumes, and this is actually the designs for Oklahoma. You get an actor, you get costume, so you can populate our proscenium with a certain set. Once you complete one show, it will move on to another show. It's the actual designs. Illustrations of the actual designs, I should say. There were some major challenges. We're not in the business of developing new technology, and we needed some partners in that, and finding those partners was really difficult. We started with a digital loyalty program called Perka. And then they were like, oh, well, we can do the loyalty part, but we can't do the gaming part, so how about we partner with this group called The Program? We were like, okay. And The Program came on board, and they were really cool, and we did a scope of work, and then Perka had to pull out because they were acquired, and The Program needed Perka to do that. So it was very, very confusing, but what ended up happening is The Program, all partners were really awesome. Program said, we're breaking up with you, but we want to introduce you to our really sexy friend, Watson Creative. And Watson Creative came on board, and they could do it all in one place. And you're looking at kind of their designers. They do digital loyalty programs for the San Francisco 49ers, for the Denver Broncos, for zoos. Really cool people, and they were very impressive in their Yahoo-esque offices on their iPads. And but it was a journey, and there were delays, and we're a little behind. With the successes, the tour's going great. We're sending a feelers out into the community all over, and we also hope to develop a histories tour to add to that. Partnering with Watson was a huge success. It ended up that Matt Watson and his wife were subscribers, and one of the marketers they used, Molly, is on our marketing committee, so it's like, okay, why didn't we figure this out to begin with? But we ended up together, so that's good. Really exciting for, I think, this group and the field is that this is integrated with Tessitura. So points, as people earn points for going to a prologue, a Q&A, pre-show concert in our lobby, the Felis tour, that will show up in their Tessitura account, so our box office patrons know and can give them you earned a free drink at the bar, here's a voucher, that sort of thing. And that will be available to other arts organizations, I think is going to be really exciting. So we are behind. We hope to go into beta next month and launch it in the fall.
That's awesome. That's really cool. All right, now I think we're gonna hear from Kristen Jackson from Woolly Mammoth. Kristen.
Hey, everybody. My name is Kristen, and I am the connectivity director at Woolly Mammoth Theater in DC. Connectivity is our community engagement strategy for both audience energizing and diversifying, as well as sort of embedding civic discourse that is going on in the nation's capital in our work, and sort of clarifying the relationship between our work and the conversations that are going on in our community. Connectivity has revolutionized the relationship between our theater and our city. And some of the best practices that we've identified in our work were articulating the civic conversation that each play aims to have with our community, reaching out to stakeholders who have a special interest in those conversations, and developing partnerships and programming to draw those stakeholders and networks to the theater, curating interactive lobby experiences that illuminate the form and the content of our plays, and encourage patrons to share their experiences and see themselves in the work. And lastly, positioning Woolly as a place where you could come to explore the ideas that were relevant to your life. But we had a little problem, which was that our department's organizational structure, which was one full-time staff member, the connectivity director, and a rotating cast of interns, was an unsustainable model. And we lacked the consistent systems designed to build upon the aforementioned best practices and gain control and consistency over the connectivity experiment. We were in need of an organizational revolution to serve our audiences better and allow the connectivity director to play more of a community ambassador role. With the help of this grant, we brought in a connectivity associate in order to increase the footprint, size, and capacity of the department, form new and longer term relationships, and also allow the connectivity director to get out of the office and into the community. Some of the next steps that we hope to be a part of our sort of connectivity revolution included increasing both the quality and quantity of our programming, and moving connectivity beyond a one-way street from Woolley out into the community by instead bringing the needs and the passions of the community into Woolley. So two examples of recent successes following the addition of the associate position that sort of speak to these needs. With the ability to spend more time in DC in our community and really show up for our partners has led to deeper, richer collaborations. One of our recent shows, Lights Rise on Grace, dealt with the challenges that returning citizens face when coming back from incarceration. We attended a social justice hackathon around rebuilding reentry. As a result of being at that hackathon, we found partners who were excited about another way to explore some of the challenges that they were facing when they were coming home after incarceration. We developed these partnerships. It led to their willingness to come to our rehearsal room and speak with our actors about their experiences. It led to a prison reentry and the arts podcast for the Court Services and Offender Supervision Agency. It led to a post-show panel about the challenges of reentry, and it led to the development of a life-size reentry board game in our lobby that was an interactive lobby experience where our patrons actually put themselves in the shoes of people facing these situations and these challenges and actually experiencing that firsthand. Another thing that we were able to do because of the addition of the associate, and this is related to these fabulous dancing people on stage, were a series that we called The Appetizers. This was where we actually invited the community into the artistic process of three new plays in development. And this is well in advance of the appetizers were in the fall and the productions were all in the spring, so well in advance. And these sort of open creative sessions allowed us to test our assumptions and allowed the partners who we involved and the audience members who were there to really help us shape what the connectivity conversations around the shows wanted to be. And it allowed us to ask them who they felt like needed to be in the room in order to have an opportunity for dialogue and an understanding. By beginning the conversation well in advance of these productions, we built relationships with key stakeholders much earlier in the process, and it allowed for these stakeholders to make more informed decisions about whether a collaboration around a particular show also served their self-interest. What you see right there, super briefly, was actually a pre-appetizer workshop with one of our longer-term partners. So it was both, the appetizers were an opportunity both to build new relationships and to continue relationships that had previously been established. I like to call it the amuse-bouche. And what you're seeing here was an opportunity for folks to come to this workshop in advance of the appetizer at our theater, and through this workshop sort of find their embodied response to some of the themes we would later be exploring and build upon. And it became an integral part of the workshop, that the appetizer workshop that actually happened at Woolley. So, in conclusion, most of these things would not have been possible without the addition of an associate position. And as we continue to revolutionize the work that we're doing with our, and our audiences continue to revolutionize our theaters, we need to continue to think about how we're preparing ourselves to do this work, how we're structured, and how we can best serve them. So, thank you so much.
You guys are like freaking smart. All right, so we're gonna take 5 minutes to talk amongst yourselves about venue path strategy.
I'm Kristen, I'm with Cincinnati, my house in Gifford.
You're a small role. Are you in the downtown area?
I mean, we're
we were not their priority. And they decided to work pro bono, so the TCG money was going to be programmed to aid. And they just loved us and decided to be a part of it. And you know, they got a class.
And we were like really nice people that put us off. What's going on? What's going on?
As they were being
quiet. We have a structure for what Earth's points, how much it is, where the awards, we have some theater venues, and we will specifically target the idea of between shows that are not too centralized to one neighborhood.
But then you'll get your neighborhood center.
What's cool is that.
Small business neighborhood.
What would have been fun?
So we'll try and pick shows for an American to buy water.
Because he's really excited. He's a sports guy. He works for him.
So
he likes the art.
What's your strategy right getting? What do you have to show there?
Properties right now. Then it's football.
So
that's exciting.
Flyering, you know, passing out things door to door, talking to me.
I hate doing this part. I know. Everybody's talking and I hate interrupting. We're going to have much more time to talk, I'm telling you. I promise you. This afternoon. But I have to interrupt you and tell you once again to stop talking. Okay. We're going to move on. To our last but not least, strategy cluster that we're going to be discussing and hearing some stories about is income, and that's really like redesigning the sort of financial exchange. Some examples of discounts, you know, dynamic pricing, sponsored tickets. And again, I'm just going to remind you, we're going to hear some stories about this, but obviously people are usually using more than one strategy cluster at one time. It's rare that you actually just use one. But at any rate, we are going to hear from Daniel at Cornerstone Theater Company in LA, right?
Yes.
You have here.
Thank you. So, hello everyone, my name's Daniel, the Artistic Associate at Cornerstone Theater Company. We make plays with and for communities. We don't have an actual theater space. We're located in Los Angeles, but we move around from different communities. And depending on how we define community being a loaded word, like many of the words here, like audience, like revolution. And one of the things that we do in order to make our work accessible and really be working with what the community is that all our shows are pay what you can, which means that we don't charge for a show. We sometimes have suggested donations, but really it's if you can donate, if you can give $5, if you can give $10, if you can give $500, we'll take that as well. If you give nothing, then that's fine as well, right? So it's about building a community, this community being the audience. I'm sure some of you have similar strategies in offering discounted tickets, student rush tickets, memberships, monthly memberships or whatnot. And we thought, okay, we're free, so our houses should always be full. And they're not, right? And so why is that? So what this led us to do is really start having these conversations with our past community members, past community participants and community organizations about, well, what else is happening here? What would get you to watch this play? And what this allowed us to do, and like they're talking about the intersections between the clusters, is to create these relationships. And now that this question was at the forefront of how can we get you into the space, we started getting answers back. Well, it's not just that it's about the money, right? It's about I don't have transportation to get there, and transportation costs me something as well. I don't have a babysitter. I can't provide. I don't have that. I have to work, and I can't go watch a play. I have to work to be able to pay for my transportation. So now we get all these. We can't solve all those problems, right? But we try to make it more accessible. But having that conversation, that direct, I think another big part about this was also that I'm embarrassed to go in and not pay anything, as other people are paying something. That was also a real conversation. I don't know what to wear to the theater, so I'm gonna feel underdressed. I don't have this, right? So what I don't have to go. So what this started doing, what we did was we created the Community Connectors program, and we had members from past community participants from our past first shows that were welcoming and inviting and creating audience for our fifth show in our Hunger Cycle Bliss Point, dealing with addiction and recovery. So we had these events around Creative Seeds, which were workshops, conversations, volunteer opportunities that allowed for these connectors who had been a part of the process before to really sit and have these types of conversations with other members and bring people that they knew. There's, you know, we talk about the different layers of audience that we have, and there's the people that are already subscribers or that know about your work and are coming to all your plays. We talk about then the people that we reach through via our social media and email blast. Then we have our community partners, our past participants, and then we have a layer of audience that these connectors had relationships with that we did not have. We don't have the time to connect with everyone. We don't have the ability, the resources to connect with everyone. But what we saw happening was really what's happening here, and we have 60 people, and I can't talk to every single person or share what it is that you would like to see or what would help you get there. But we have about one or two people from this audience revolution that are having these more in-depth conversations. So I think that's the Creative Seeds events were also open and free and available. They were in the community. They were with our past partners. That was also something that was really exciting to build that relationship with our past partners, because they're like, well, what is it going to cost us? Nothing. We want to come to your space, and if we can, we'll give you a donation. This grant also allowed us to hire a contract, the Community Connectors, so they were getting paid for their time and working with us. And what they did is they really took the ownership and were empowered to build and be the audience for these shows. I don't want to make it seem also that it's all about money, but I think it's really diving deeper into that issue of income and finances and what we can do as a company if we're saying, we want you to come see our shows. It's not just about, here's a ticket, now you're here. What are the next levels of that, and what is else preventing there? So it's a beautiful opportunity to really have those conversations and get into that and dive in deeper with that. I think that's pretty much good, unless, yeah. A little bit better program.
Cool. Last but not least, we're going to hear from Nancy at Dallas Children's Theater.
Hello. So, Dallas Children's Theater is committed to serving every child. Like we've been hearing, how important and life-changing theater is. And we started to really realize that there was a segment of our community that we were not serving in the best way that we could, because parents started coming to us saying, could you please adapt your programming for my child on the autistic spectrum, my child who has sensory processing challenges? And then they were saying, when will you adapt your programming? And we said, yeah, we're going to do that, and we're going to do that really soon. And then this grant came to us, and we thought, this is the way to try and make this work. So we somebody's asked me how much the grant is. Can I say?
Yeah.
I think it was like
up to $65,000. And one of the magic best parts is that there's.
And one of the best parts, with great thanks to our friends at the Doris Duke Charitable Foundation, who I haven't already thanked. Is the general operating support, which is approximately 30% of your grant amount. So it's very rare in that way.
Yes, and it was a godsend, because we were able to travel to two of our sister theaters, to Nashville and to Orlando, and to see how they were doing this work and how they were adapting their programming. And so it paid for that. And then we brought them to us, and we had a kind of a mini conference with our national partners and with our local community partners. These were the folks from Autism Speaks, from the children's hospitals, from the universities, and we all talked about how to do this work. And a big important part was discussed in another session yesterday was, yeah, you're gonna make some mistakes. And that's okay. Don't let that keep you from doing the work. So that was, I always kept that in my head. I thought, what if I say it the wrong way? What if I, you know, it's okay. Have good heart and it'll go. So one of the things that our wonderful community partner said was to charge. We were gonna do the first show for free, and they said, that's putting no value on that. So we did $5, which, you know, was much cheaper than our normal ticket price. But, and if anybody called in and needed a scholarship or had a group of kiddos, yes, they got free tickets. But that was so great. And so that's part of the income strategy there. But we learned so much from our partners, and we learned so much from the families coming. The other important thing that we did were surveys with the parents. Evaluation, you know, we're all asked to do this evaluation. Well, we asked questions like, of course, did your child enjoy the show, but did your child talk to someone they didn't know? So this is important. And our community partners helped us come up with these questions. What was great was we set a baseline of saying, hopefully 75% of the people will say yes. 95% of the people said yes. So that was very helpful in finding the next round of grants, because what we then did was leverage these dollars to apply for a very large grant from a community partner that only usually does the children's hospitals and the teen rape victims. I mean, the very serious child issues. They wanted to pay for this, and because we had some of this evaluation and survey information from the parents, it was very helpful. And we've actually gotten several grants. We got a local Unitarian church gave us their weekly donation one week, because, I mean, church can be okay, you know? So they, we got to go and speak, and they gave us the most, $3,000, but hey, that paid for some tickets. So, you know, this turned out to be a good opportunity for us to learn and to grow and to be able to serve these children, because we've also heard that it's the siblings, you know, that suffer too, because brother or sister just is having a meltdown and can't go out. So tomorrow I'm doing, with Erica from the McCarter, we're doing a toolkit about how to do this, because part of this is we want to share this information. We did another little mini conference this past January, just sort of on our own with our local, all the museums and everybody, and talking about how you can do this work, and we've already got great feedback that they're doing it. So it as Ben Cameron said once years ago, that this is God's work, and it's joyous and it's wonderful, and I thank everyone and encourage you to put your toe in the water.
Very proud, Carl. All right. Talk to your neighbors about it when you come. Like you don't talk about that enough, right?
I love what
she
said about
it.
Giving and all stuff about it. It never works. I've witnessed that too. Things have learned. $5 to
there's a part of me that thinks it's great when you don't have
there's no expectation.
Yeah. Great if you have over there.
Yeah, we did. Consistently, program is free to the general public, and more recently, it was up to 40% admission rate. We overbook our houses and then pray.
Other than maybe once every
week, the 40% is just. And you don't see that as much.
I think the challenge that I've asked to bring about a lot of connections with a lot of organizations.
There sometimes is the assumption that the barrier to theater is present. And that's not typically the leading reason. It may be that it's an interest in the programming, or it may be all of those other factors that But we often, on the marketing side of things at the very least, we often hear, oh, you just need to discount your ticket prices, and then the audience will come. That, I will say, I don't necessarily think that it is true all the time.
And all the arts organizations, we have one night that is paid for. You know, we have the arts hall. There's waiting. The standby line is $20. You know? And then you will always have a patron who wants to sell on Saturday night.
We did recently.
Glad you're doing, but no one here.
And it's not going to the groups that you want it to be.
partially because it's like they go on sale on Tuesdays and the box office buy those tickets
that you can't get. And we reach out to some that are grants from Department of Fire.
So we're looking for
it is!
People actually don't always show up.
Better drive that than we do.
Okay. All right. Great. Thank you. You guys, I want to bring your attention, before I hand it over to Amelia to wrap us up, I want to bring your attention one more time to this table over here. We have some case studies from four theaters, from Long Wharf, from Youth Speaks in San Francisco, from Arkansas Rep, and from the Theater Offensive in Boston. Please take these and read them. They're actually, they say draft on them, so they're drafts, but please take them. And we also have a book here called The Road to Results from Wallace. The Wallace Foundation is doing a lot of work, as you probably know, on audience building, so please take some of this information home with you. But I'm gonna hand it to Amelia.
Hey, thank you guys. Hopefully those conversations we've had so far were helpful, productive for you. When you come back in the second session after lunch, you'll be organized by strategy cluster, the clusters we've just been talking about earlier today. And to help us do that sorting, I think JP has got the prototype intake form, which is really pretty straightforward, just a brief one-sentence description about the strategy model thing that you want to explore, get some group think around. And what really will help us organize you all for this afternoon is what cluster you believe it falls into. And there can be some tweaking and changing as you think about that. You're not locked into it. But again, that will just help us do a bit of organizing. Also this afternoon, we'll have a little bit more specifics about round two of the Audience Revolution Grant Program, how we tweaked it, how we changed it, and hopefully how you can access it. So lunch right now, we actually would love to collect the intake forms before you leave. So if you can take a couple of moments to fill those out, we can collect them. We still have a couple of moments before the end of the session. And then when you leave, lunch is in the state lobby, the state theater lobby where you were just earlier. So let us know if you've got any questions about any of this. Thanks.
If anyone didn't get one, just raise your hand. Or